Oh, hey, I'm Coco, and welcome to our talk show, Single and Too Tired to Mingle. We'll be talking about relationships with ourselves, our exes, our kids, and other important beings. So stay tuned. Professor Deborah Christie, welcome back.
Hi, hello.
Love having my guests back. It's so good. So last time we spoke about adolescence. Mm-hmm. Today, you're obviously a clinical psychologist. We're going to talk about a very prevalent topic, which is obesity and childhood obesity. So we're going to look at that from a psychological perspective. First, we're just going to give some data and some stats about that for the UK and the US. So for the UK, we have a prevalence of obesity at reception level in children around 10%. Mm-hmm. That was in the year 2021. It says it kind of went down in 22, 23 to 9.2%. Then we have prevalence of obesity in year six children. That's somewhere around 23%. That's in the UK. And what's interesting is, and perhaps not surprising, I don't know, you can tell me, it's higher in children from more deprived backgrounds. And we can talk about why that is as well. So the prevalence there is about 12% higher than comparing to their kind of well-off counterparts. And in the US, the prevalence of obesity is around 19.7%, which in numbers is 14.7 million children. So I think in numbers, we actually get to see the extent of the issue. So that's in children and adolescents. And obesity prevalence was around 12.7% in 2 to 5 year olds. Mm. So in your experience as a clinical psychologist, what would you kind of say about those numbers and about obesity in general? What is it? Where does it come from?
Well, it's a big topic. It's a big topic. And it's a quite an emotive topic. Okay. It can be quite distressing. There is definitely a shift in how Western societies function. And we live in an obesogenic environment, an environment that encourages overweight and obesity. So it's not just obesity, but overweight, how much we weigh compared to what our average body weight perhaps should or could be. And that's because of so many different factors. I mean, we just couldn't cover everything. It's such a complicated picture. There's an amazing diagram that I should send you that you could put up and show people if they're watching the podcast, that shows the number of different factors that will influence whether somebody is or isn't overweight. It's just not as simple. Everybody likes to break it down into, oh, it's this or it's that. It is hundreds of different factors. So there will be things like your family environment. And that family environment will include things like the genetics. Mm-hmm. So if your parents are overweight, you are more likely to be overweight yourself. That's partly genetic, but it's also how the family lifestyle.
Yeah, I was going to ask.
It's also going to be what kinds of foods the family buy, what foods are in the family house. You talked about deprivation. If you have very limited income, your ability to buy more expensive, healthy, what we think of as healthy foods, is going to be influenced. If you have an incredibly busy time trying to make money, then you have less time to cook from scratch, and so you're more likely to use high density, high carb, takeaway kind of food, or processed, highly processed foods. And of course, there's recently some suggestion that ultra processed foods will encourage weight gain. There's the fact that kids don't walk to school anymore, that they don't exercise as much. And the old idea that it was a simple balance, you know, I remember when I used to teach about it and we used to say, you know, it's energy out has to be more than energy in order for you to lose weight. That's kind of true. Mm-hmm. It is kind of true. And at a very simple level, if you put somebody in a room and you don't give them enough calories, they will slowly starve to death. But of course, nobody just sits in a room. Yeah. Everybody's, you know, walking home from school and nipping into the chippy for a poke of chips, or they're sitting watching the telly and having a bag of crisps. And I can't remember actually the exact numbers, but it's something as crazy as if you just have 100 calories a day over what your body actually needs, you will put on a stone by the end of the year or something mad.
Yeah, I would agree with that.
It is, I mean.
Especially the older you get.
Yeah, well, and then, and of course there's age. Yeah. There's age. But when.
Well, let's talk about the child.
We won't worry about ourselves.
About my own traumas.
That's right. Do I look big? Does my bum look good in this picture? Is the question. I think it's about complexity. And I think that one of the things that's frustrating is the way that people try and break it down and make it really simple and just say, oh, you are overweight because of this. Actually, people are overweight. Children are overweight because of an enormous number of different factors, some of which are controllable and some of which they aren't.
If I'm thinking about schools,
yeah,
like the amount of time that as children we sat and children sit in schools now is you spend half of the day in a system where you're just sitting.
Yeah.
More or less, right? Mm. Instead of actually children moving around. What about this snacking culture maybe? And we can talk about maybe cross-cultural differences as well. So I'm a tennis coach and one lesson usually lasts an hour. And I've had parents come up to me and say, oh, are the kids going to have a break so they can have a snack? Mm. I'm like, no, it's 1 hour. They can have a water break. Mm. So I think the snacking culture is quite big here in the UK. Can we maybe compare that to other countries? Everyone had an obesity issue?
No, I mean,
globally,
it's a global Western phenomenon. Right. It's not lower middle income countries. Lower middle income countries don't have the same issue. I mean, if you look at the data, there's some really interesting graphs that show countries like China and look at tracking the Chinese obesity rates and the number of McDonald's. Right. For example, and they just track each other. You know, the more fast food outlets you have in a country, the higher the level of obesity. And it's because snacks aren't thought of as meals. So if you think to yourself, well, actually, somebody needs 2,500 calories, 3,000 calories, and that's then broken down into a breakfast and a lunch and a dinner. You can stick to that number of calories in a breakfast, lunch and dinner, and you then forget the biscuit you had with the tea and the cake you had because it was somebody's birthday and the packet of crisps because you were bored. And as I've said, the poker chips on the way home, and suddenly you've had another 1,000 calories. A thousand. What is it, a Big Mac and fries? I can't even remember how many thousands that is.
We were looking at a small bag of chips the other day. Yeah. Like the smallest bag. It has 1,000 calories.
That's mad.
Are you serious?
It's mad. It is mad.
It was hard to fathom, actually.
And the portion sizes have got bigger. I mean, the supersizing. I mean, if you think about supersizing, or like, for example, if you go to the States and you order a meal, the portions are insane.
Yeah.
And just things like a brownie or a latte, if you have a latte from one of, you know, other coffee shops are available. Yeah. You know, any one of the coffee shops that are out there, a latte and a brownie are going to put you 600, 700 calories. That's a third of your that's a third of what you need, and you just had it because you had it on the way to work. So our whole culture is not designed to allow us to have that leaner hunter gatherer frame that our ancestors have, and the rise of the fast foods have outstripped the evolutionary change. So we're now, as I said, we live in an obesogenic environment where everything is designed to put on weight.
Is there a way back?
Oof. I think there's definitely self-awareness. I think if people are aware, the problem, of course, is that you then get stuck into this issue around whether or not you end up with eating disorders with kids.
Right, yeah.
So there has definitely been discussion around, if we take a kid who is overweight and we start to say to them, you need to lose weight, you need to lose weight, and we then start getting them thinking about what they eat and thinking about their calories and thinking about all of this, that they then get, and they get socially rewarded.
Right.
Because what happens when you lose weight? People go, oh, you look fabulous. You look so good. And it's like, no. And so, of course, people then go, oh, okay, so I'll look more fabulous if I lose a bit more weight. Now, that's simplistic, because anorexia and bulimia are not caused by people saying you look good when you're losing weight. It's another podcast, isn't it? It's an entire other podcast. But if you do get to a point where you become obsessed with what you eat, you become miserable.
Sure.
And so therefore, one of the other outcomes that is that you end up being unhappy because you're restricting, and restricting is bad for us. So I think it's, how do you create a healthy environment? How do you create a positive environment where food is good? And that was one of the things that we always used to teach kids when we worked with kids that were overweight. We would say, it's not that there are bad foods and good foods. It's there are, all food is good, but you need to think about, how do you create a balance so that you are managing what you eat to allow your body with teenagers, the kind of, for a long time, the idea was, rather than trying to get teenagers to lose weight, you get them to stop putting on weight so that they continue to grow. They kind of stretch them out a bit. But of course, being overweight is, again, very stigmatizing. It's one of the main reasons for stigma in our culture. It's one of the last bastions of allowable joke making.
Okay.
Not appropriate to make jokes about people's ethnicity or religion, or whether they're a mother-in-law. You're not allowed to make mother-in-law jokes. You're not allowed to do any of those. But apparently, you know, it feels like it's okay for people to be rude and make jokes about people who are overweight. The language that's used to describe people that are overweight is pejorative. It's biased and it's prejudicial. So, it's not helped by media and by social media and by people posting pictures of themselves in their bikinis.
You've
had a little go with the rubber to take off your
I've actually seen that in action. There's a girl doing it on the plane next
terrifying.
To me. I'm like, wow. I know. I've never seen that before.
I know. And it's so sad, because actually all bodies are lovely.
Yeah.
We need to try and find a way of making kids feel good about themselves. And of course, there's that wonderful stuff that Susie Orbach talked about years ago. I'm an old feminist, emphasis on the old. But as a feminist, what Susie Orbach talked about was, when women stopped dieting, they lost weight. And it was the obsession with the dieting and the obsession with that got into your head.
Talking about social media and celebrities and what we see and what children see at the end of the day. We see celebrities that are overweight, let's say, by some medical standards. And there's a lot of talk about body positivity. Where is that fine line between, or is there a fine line between body positivity and actual obesity?
Okay. I think it's really hard to draw a fine line. There's not a single, here you're good and here you're not good. I think the line is health. Are you healthy?
Okay.
Rather than, are you skinny or fat?
Okay, that's a good point. Yeah.
And if you, because there was a great study that which showed that healthy, fit, overweight people had lower mortality rates than skinny smokers.
Right. Okay. Yeah. Good point.
Yeah. So being slightly overweight becomes protective as we get older as well. Having a little bit more weight on us is a bit more protective. So it's not so much about what do you weigh, but do you have a healthy lifestyle?
Okay.
Because people have different body types. So there are the skinnies, there are the slightly more rounded, and then there are the people who are more overweight. But if the person that's overweight by medical definition, and that's a really important thing because it's just a number on a chart.
Yeah.
You know, what do you weigh according to your height? And you get this
the BMI,
which is a useless measure, really. Most people will say it's not a useful measure, that you need to understand the body mass index as a function of how much muscle you've got, where the weight is. Right. Whether it's around your organs or not, but also are you exercising on a regular basis? So it's much better to be slightly overweight and exercise regularly than be skinny and not exercise at all. So I think health is the issue.
Okay.
We shouldn't fat shame. We shouldn't fat shame, but pretty much everybody does. It's really, really hard.
Does it make us feel better when we shame other people?
Yeah.
Is that
kind of where
it comes from?
Yeah, because if we're shaming them, then we're othering them.
Yeah, exactly.
They're different to me. I don't look like that, so I feel better about myself. Yeah. And it's unpleasant. And when I worked with the kids, I used to hear awful stories. People would stop their cars and wind their windows down and shout stuff out the window. I mean, there are a lot of haters around there, and it is really difficult to understand why people develop this kind of obsessive hatred of people who are overweight. It's just but I think it's very driven by social media. I think it's very driven by the mainstream media that we need to blame somebody, and so we'll blame people who are overweight.
It was actually interesting. I was in Cairo some years back, and I have to say that I noticed there wasn't a single billboard promoting anything to do with the body.
Mm.
There were no products advertised. All the women were out and happy and just dressed normally. And I thought, so interesting, when you drive around London, for example, or, you know, you see either on one end of the spectrum or the other end of the spectrum, but there was nothing. And I thought, actually, it's so healthy, and actually it felt kind of calming that you're not looking at this all the time, how you should be. Mm. And I think men face the same stigma. They should be looking like this. They should all be shaved. They should all have six packs. So I don't think it's just women that, or girls that are put through this. I think it's boys that struggle as well with what they see.
They do. And we know that there's increased in eating disorders in boys. It's a slightly different version, but there's a lot of stuff coming out in the States about eating disorders in boys. And again, it's about how bodies are portrayed in the media, and expectations and friendship groups and clothes, availability of clothes.
It's all driven by sales at the end of the day, right?
It comes down to money, doesn't it? Yeah. It's difficult, and it's very, very hard to lose weight. I think that's the other thing. Maybe that's the bit that needs to be said as we coming to a close. It's so hard to lose weight.
That is true.
It's an enormous effort.
It is.
And
it's so easy to put it on.
One packet of crisps.
Yeah, that's it.
Put that packet of crisps down.
That is true.
Now.
Yeah, it's true. And the biscuits.
And the biscuits.
Because once you have a watch and you're running a little bit, you can see how little you consume versus how quickly you put that on. It's actually like for one biscuit, you have to run half an hour.
Yeah. Puts you off biscuits. Yeah. Or it puts you off running.
Yeah, depends.
I think you make your own decision on that one. Yeah. Personally, I think I'd rather have the biscuit than run for half an hour. It's like, really, is that worth it?
Yeah, that's it. So as a clinical psychologist, let's just kind of look at the psychological aspect of obesity and adolescence, let's say, kind of coming to a close, and then you're going to leave us with a positive takeaway.
I am.
For all these adolescents and also for the adults.
Well, it is hard work. I definitely think that one of the things that helps the most is helping young people feel confident. and regaining their lives. There is something around education and awareness. It's important that you understand why you're making the choices that you do. When we're trying to motivate people, it's always about why are you doing this? What are the positives for you? So sometimes young people won't want to lose weight because there will be a whole host of reasons that weight for them is protective. Mm-hmm. For other young people, they do want to lose weight because they feel unhappy. They find it stigmatizing and it's not serving them. It's so unhelpful to just say to somebody, you need to eat less and you need to exercise more. That polarizing, simplistic statement is completely unhelpful. Okay. You've got to understand why are people overweight and what's in it for them in order for them to change how they are living in the wider culture.
Right.
In order to change their body habitus, if you like.
Okay.
So that would be that. I think that's the thing. And it is really important to make people out there realize it is not easy. If you're already overweight, you know this. But if you are a hater and you are finding yourself making judgments about people mm-hmm. who are overweight, please understand that it is incredibly difficult to shift. And a lot of people try. But again, because of the culture and the world that we're living in, it's not easy. It's not easy.
Yeah, and also everyone has something. Maybe someone is overweight, but I'm every single person has something. Yeah. So let's try not to shame other people. Exactly. Instead, work on ourselves a little bit.
That would be very important. Yeah, focus on yourself before you focus on others. Yeah.
That's it. Deborah, thank you so much for coming back. We loved having you again.
Pleasure. Thank you. Thank you for asking me again.
We'll see you soon, hopefully again. See you.